gamers and gamers, it's here, and welcome back to the Over the Hedge walkthrough. Last time around, we tackled Smith Heist Part 2. And today, we're going to be tackling the Smith House, which is the third part of the Smith Heist. And so, without further ado, let's head into the extras menu and see what goodies we picked up last time. Okay, so starting off for concept art, we got... Hammy. Oh, wait, no, we already had that, never mind. We got Vern in the yard, which is an early, this seems to be an early sketched drawing of what Vern looked like, or what the scene was supposed to captivate when Vern's first steps onto the other side of the hedge to discover the other world, or not the other world, but the world outside the hedge, the suburbia, essentially. For movies, we got birthday party intro, and I believe that's pretty much everything we got. We got another storyboard. Oh! We got a storage log. And something interesting I want to point out with this one is that if you actually look at it, right here, you can see that there's two little blue illuminating thingies. Which, first off, beautiful shot. Art design in this game is great. Especially for a 6th generation console. But something I want to point out there... Oh! Heather spin! What I wanted to point out was that... The blue illuminating thingies are supposed to represent... That's the area where you select your characters, so during the design process of the game, it actually shows you where the character select was originally intended to be. So, kind of cool we can see a little behind the design process for that one. Still no new storyboards, but for music, nothing. Original comics, we skipped to number 6, apparently. Going straight to number 7. Red Lash for Lenin is the water. Whatever. Okay. So with that in mind, let's head right back into the woods and return to darkness. No, return to the world of the Smith Heist, and not finish it off, but you know, get 75% of the way there. We're halfway done with this heist, so let's do it. It's the last of this heist for this week, so that's something at least. Our primary goals are to get to the living room and open the basement door, as well as tossing the food to Penny. And our secondary objectives are to find 8 batteries and never get shocked. That should give you a pretty good indication of how difficult this one's gonna be. Actually, the shocking's only for a small portion of it, but... Anyway.
Sorry to interrupt everyone, but I'm afraid I'm the bearer of grim news. What I'm about to say you may find disturbing, if not outright quasi...
Is it about the electrified floor? We're looking right at it.
Oh, well, never mind then.
Thanks, Ozzy. We'll take it from here.
The same people who let their kids play in a laser-filled backyard cookie box right there, and then there's a chip container up in these two pinks right here. Nothing in this watering can, so you don't have to worry about that. The same people... First battery right there. Have a shock floor in the laundry room. Who in their right mind sat down and thought, that'll be a good idea. Anyway, it's two main rooms where the shocking is. It's in this room and then it's in the billiards room. If you can survive those two rooms, you're pretty much all right. There's a second battery over here, and that's just to prove my point. There's nothing in this watering can except a pizza. But I don't think that spawns there every time. You'll find a DreamWorks hat in this can right here, and if you're wondering how I know it's a DreamWorks hat, tough to tell on your first run. It says it on the cap. Very bizarre, I know, but it's a cap we earned. So far we've got a party hat, a safari hat, and a DreamWorks hat from this adventure. So, or from this heist, I guess you can technically consider a heist an adventure. Come on, rats. Come to papa. Do-do-do. Done. Grab your... What are these things called? I can never remember what these things are called for some reason. Hey, time to die. Gotcha. That's this room cleared out. Let's move on to the billiards room. Where, once again, we've got a little twist. This time, There are RJ, you're such a fool. There are rabbits that we have to deal with. And perhaps the best strategy I can employ here is to try and trap the rabbits in a corner, but don't fall off yourself, because they can't, well, they can hop out of the way of a corner. But if you're quick enough to keep attacking them, then there's not much they're going to be able to do to hop away. But other than that, you should be pretty all right. Just try your best to trap them in a corner. If you can't do that, then just keep bashing on them until they die. When you need to, use the ground pound to stun them. That helps for getting them into corners because it gives you that split second of an advantage. If you can keep pounding on them, you might just be able to trick more than one into a corner at the same time. Come on. Got them. And then there's always the strategy of waiting until they pounce, hopping in the other direction, or just hopping over them. Whatever floats your boat. Now, you're not invincible. You can actually fall off of this thing. I don't want to demonstrate it because obviously then I couldn't get the secondary objective. But you can easily get knocked off this thing. You can't walk straight off of it, obviously. Actually, you can walk straight off of it, but you're just bumping up against the edge isn't going to do it because there's a slight incline. But if you're forcefully trying to go over the edge like I just tried to do there, yeah, you're going to fall over the edge unless you're quick enough to jump back on. But once you take out these rabbits, it's not going to shut off the electric floor, obviously. That would make no logical sense. The on-off switch that we have to initiate is right over there. So we'll have to go over there to turn off the electric floor. But after we do that, the electric floor will be disabled, and we will not have to worry about getting shocked anymore. Okay, come on. One more rabbit. Done.
Okay, so now all we have to do is get to that switch, right?
Let's show that switch how we do business downtown.
All right. Now there is a golf club in one of these things, but there's not much else that you can break on the scale. You can't break the pool balls, can't break the stick. So, one way or the other, I don't recommend trying to get any of the collectibles, except for the CD inside of this telephone, until you disable the electric floor. Objective complete, never get shocked. Grab the third battery out of this corner right here, and now let's worry about getting the rest of the collectibles. Or, actually, are there any collectibles in this room? There's a fourth battery right here. And then there's a pizza, I think, was in there. In here, you'll find a chip container, and that's it, right? There's nothing else in this room, or is there something along the back wall? There is something along the back wall, but it's not breakable, it's just a painting. Alright, so yeah, that's all the collectibles for this room. So let's move on to the next room. And, boop.
Wow, it smells great in here. Kind of like our forest, only chemically processed.
It's that thing! It puffs out fake wood scent!
If humans like the smell of woods, why don't they just use real trees?
If a can sprays and there's no one to smell it, does it give off a scent? I wonder why they need so much.
Because rats stink?
It's incredible how well the dialogue works together with each other, regardless of who you pick. Anyway. And no, I didn't forget to switch out characters. I'm gonna switch characters when we get to the heist. I think that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna keep the main characters the same until we get to the heist, the escape, not the heist. And then once we beat the escape, I'll switch it up again. I'll switch it up when it makes logical sense too, like, because it's been Vern and RJ along the adventure of going through everything, so I think from a cinematic perspective, it'll make more sense if I keep things going like that. Anyway, you don't have to stand still to take out these guys. You can actually move around. Just don't step on the gray patches that look like rugs, otherwise that's going to happen. You're going to get put to sleep. Can I grab the ball by a certain time? No, I cannot. Good to know. Alright, so in this next room, there's three main... Well, there's 10 bunnies, but three are going to spawn initially. Fifth battery over here, and then a cookie box inside of this lamp for some reason. Apparently, you know, people like to do binge eating sessions when watching their favorite television show. I guess. I don't know. Anyway, you may remember in the last episode that I mentioned that we were going to be introduced to a brand new enemy this episode. We are. And it's an annoying one. Fortunately, you were only going to encounter said enemy a handful of times throughout the course of the game. So you don't really have to worry all that much about it. It's just that in the few times you do encounter it, it's not exactly a cakewalk. Chip container inside these board games? I think that's what they are. It's hard to tell, but I'm going to go with it. You can't activate anything in the TV. Trust me, I've tried. There's a chip container inside of here along with your sixth battery. Inside here, nothing. Inside the lamp, cookie box. Inside this vase, nothing. Inside this plant, a CD to unlock some music. Music's probably one of the rarest things you can get out of those CDs. I think that because you unlock the least of that, so you're much more likely to get concept art, movies, and original comics are probably the second rarest because you get more of them, but they're not as easily come by as concept art and movies are. Okay. These bunnies are just wrecking me, aren't they? I'm not doing a lot of damage to these guys. Come on. Kaboom! Da-da. Da-da-da-do. Okay, these guys just ripping through us. RJ's almost down in it. Oh, then again, RJ's kind of incompetent when I'm not controlling him. The AI is really incompetent sometimes. I don't know if it's just because I'm playing on hard mode right now that the AI is so incompetent, but it's just, they die so quickly. Or maybe it's not the AI's incompetent, it's that they can't handle the level of difficulty being chucked at them. I'm gonna give them the benefit of the doubt and say that's the case. Okay, come on. Come to Papa, we're halfway done. To-do. Nope, not down and out yet. This might be time for some... Oh, RJ. Aha, the trap. Well, not trapped, but we're in an opportunity to do some... buddy power! Can we? No, stop it. Get out of my way. We were trying to do buddy power. I want to do buddy power. Hey. Oh, RJ needs energy. Oh, this doesn't work. Switch, get on top of her own shoulders. Get on top of, what are you doing? Oh wait, why did I switch to the character that doesn't have a lot of health? That was a bad idea. Duh. I will bring RJ back from the grave. Vern, get over here so we can do buddy power. What is happening? This is a bad idea. Da-da-da. Oh, how am I getting RJ so much health back? Vern, buddy power, come on, Vern, get out of the corner, Vern, yes, buddy power, alright, let's do this, rip through the bunnies, rip through the last of them, one more, where are you? Aha, beat him up, I'm gonna save some of my energy power for the next section, because we're gonna have a little mini boss battle, yes!
Let's multiply.
Ooh, that was an intense battle. A fun one, but an intense one. Ooh. Alright. So there's nothing in these cabinets, by the way, for those wondering. Now we're gonna head down into the basement. And in turn, encounter a brand new enemy. Friends,
what's a badger doing
meet the badger.
I'm no expert, but I'd say picking turtle shell out of his teeth in just a few seconds.
Alright, so his attack pattern is rather simple. You just have to get behind him and then start wailing away. By the second you're in front of him, he's gonna just attack, he's gonna lunge himself at you, and you're not gonna be able to do much about it. So don't ever, for any reason, proactively try and get behind him, or sorry, in front of him to attack him. That's not a good idea. And long-ranged attacks aren't a bad idea. It's just that if he's, as you just saw there, he's got a pretty far lunging ability, concept art, so if he's quick enough, he can lunge himself at you and attack you. But if you're behind him, it's going to take them an extra second to realize where you are. So, just my preferred strategy. Alright. Cookie box inside that box right there. Objective complete. Find 8 batteries. That's both of our secondary objectives completed. Only got one little section of this left, but I do want to collect everything for awaken. This box not be broken. I thought the box could be broken. I guess not. The next section is another one of the food-throwing sections, and I do not believe we've had one of these since last week on Tuesday when we did the Martin House. So, alright, let's do this.
Look at all that food, then. Oh.
Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow ye diet.
Hey, Lou, you up there?
You betcha, hon. Come help load up the wagon there.
Alrighty, then. Now, Lou will fill you in on what he wants. I'll go up and give him a hand while you fill her up. Sound good? Super, then.
This is definitely different from everything we've done before. You'll notice it says 10 cereal right there, but that's not what it says. Because watch what happens when I throw him this cereal. He decides, nah, I want some ice cream now. Have you figured it out yet? I'll wait until it changes again. What? I wasn't fast enough. Garbage. It's not that he wants 10 of 10, whatever the red bag is, 10 ice cream, 10 chips. He wants 10 total food items, but what he wants changes with each round. Doesn't make a whole lot of logical sense, But nonetheless, that's how this works. So basically, you just have to keep a keen eye as to what you want, grab it, and immediately run back. You can generally throw it generally where I'm standing right now, so just be keen to throw. And if you can get half or more done before the timer crosses the halfway mark, you should be good to go. So just keep checking, and if you're not quick enough, it's going to flash. Try not to miss more than three, because after you do that, you may as well. Unless you're really, really expedient and you get really, really lucky, there's not a good chance you'll be able to do much if you miss three or more in a row. Okay, ice cream. I don't think I'm going to be able to do this one, so I'm just going to go as fast as I can. Maybe... Nope! Yeah, that's not going to happen. Do you still want ice cream? No, you do not. Okay. I can do this. I believe in myself. Get the Cheerios. Because the problem is, once you have to resort to this second shelf, then your chances is... RJ, don't throw it at him. Yeah, thank you. You're extremely helpful there, Penny. We're good. As you can see, I only missed one there. I missed two, I think. And I still almost didn't do it. But success! Level complete! So, I'd like to thank you for watching. Stay tuned for the next episode, and until then, it's been GameMatic13. Signing off, saying I hope you have a fantastic world today, and I'll catch you all next time for some more Over the Hedge. Goodbye! We're rocking the suburbs. We're rocking the suburbs.